everyone. I'm Michelle Long. It's 9 in Manila, 10 in Tokyo, and 9 p.m. in New York. The headlines. Asian markets looking mixed this morning following a tech-driven rally on Wall Street overnight. Traders await bank results to kick off the first quarter earnings season. Well, here at home, the PSE index kicks off from 66.77, also on track for a second weekly loss. The Philippines, U.S., and Japan set to open a so-called Luzon Corridor of Investments after the trilateral summit happening in Washington. Japan and Washington also commit to provide millions of dollars to set up an Open Radio Access Network, or ORAN, technology here in Manila. Expect more inflationary pressure from oil next week as the price of petroleum products are expected to rise again for a fourth consecutive time. And later, we speak with a maker of the iconic King of the Road jeepneys, Francisco Motors, about the state of jeepney manufacturing and their ambitious plan to help PUV drivers modernize. We begin with stocks. Markets in Asia opening mixed after a tech-driven rally on Wall Street. Let's take a look at the board. Shares in Australia, even futures for Hong Kong pointing lower. While Japan is seeing some modest gains, the Nikkei 225 up by about half of 1%. The yen fairly steady after softening yesterday. The currency had earlier slumped to its weakest against the dollar since 1990, prompting many to speculate authorities will start to intervene. Meanwhile, gold climbing to a fresh record after the latest U.S. inflation print, that is the producer price index, offered some calm to the markets. Up ahead, we are waiting to get China's trade numbers. Now, stateside, U.S. futures looking pretty good with the Dow leading gains up by a tenth of 1% for futures. And the S&P and the NASDAQ also marginally higher when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Now, in commodities again, oil resuming gains ahead of a report from the International Energy Agency on the outlook as traders brace for a potential strike on Israel by Iran or its proxies. The West Texas Intermediate climbing towards $86 a barrel after closing 1.4% lower the previous session, while Brent settled near $90. Oil now on track for a weekly loss, but prices are still around 19% higher this year, in part due to OPEC Plus supply cuts. The world's largest tech companies drove a rebound on Wall Street Thursday, with traders now bracing for a deluge of results from corporate America that could test or support this year's $4 trillion rally. Earnings season kicks into full swing today with JP Morgan Chase, Wells Fargo, and Citigroup Inc. reporting their numbers. According to a Bloomberg data, a 3.8% projected annual earnings growth per share for Q1 for S&P 500 members is being priced in. Also helping lift sentiment was an inflation report focused on producer prices, showing a rise, but one that trailed estimates and already showing some relief in key categories, rekindling hopes that inflation, while ticking higher, remains in a cooling trend. Let's take a look at the board. The S&P hovering near 5,200, while the NASDAQ is up by 1.7%. That says Alphabet got closer to the $2 trillion mark. Amazon also hitting a record high, while Apple jumped on news that it plans to overhaul its Mac line.
Economically, we've had a really good quarter. Until just the last few days, even, we've seen rates move down all quarter, and we had a strong stock market. So I expect these bank earnings to be really strong. We're going to be looking at JP Morgan first thing in the morning. We're looking at BlackRock that's going to really reflect some of those trends in the market. What I care most about is what they see going forward. I think we're going to have strong earnings from the quarter, maybe even upside surprises. But given the stickiness of inflation that we're seeing, we're really going to want to hear what these banks see in their business trends for the next quarter and the rest of the year.
The euro dropped after the European Central Bank signaled cooling inflation will soon allow it to cut rates. Now, here is a look at the local corporate headlines we're watching this morning. State Pension Fund Social Security System has chosen Metrobank to manage a 1.5 billion peso balanced fund by investing in various equities and fixed income assets. Metrobank Trust's mandate actually started back in February and is slated to run for the next 3 years. And Meralco Energy, or MSERV, has been tapped by Allied Care Experts, or ACE Group of Hospitals, for the installation of electrical facilities that are crucial to the day-to-day operations of two medical centers in the country. MSERV turned over the load-side facilities that include two first private poles and six 250 kVA transformers for San Jose del Monte Muzon Medical Center in Bulacan and ACE Medical Center Sariaya in Quezon. ACE Group of Hospitals is a nationwide network of hospitals which currently has around 30 medical centers nationwide. And we have this, Justin. Jerry, or Global Estate Resorts, Inc., a premier developer of integrated tourism and leisure townships owned by the Andretan Group, as actually reporting net income to parent company shareholders grew 3% to 1.8 billion pesos for 2023, as consolidated revenues grew by 14% to 8.3 billion pesos. They're saying the exceptional growth was propelled by strong performance across its business segments, including real estate, rental, and hotel operations. Just a bit of a background and a breakdown. Real estate sales actually grew 10%. Hitting 6.5 billion pesos, driven by improvements of real estate bookings from the company's projects in Boracay New Coast, Southwood City, and Twin Lakes. Reservation sales, meantime, hitting 19.2 billion pesos, marking its full recovery from 2019 and highlighting the sustained demand for its innovative property offerings. Hotel segment benefiting from a resurgence in travel back online tourism, recording a 35% surge in revenues to 567 million pesos. We do know that Jerry has 9 tourism estates and integrated lifestyle communities across the country, covering more than 3,300 hectares of land. Shifting gears now, more investment pledges committed to the Philippines as the trilateral summit in Washington takes place. The White House announced Japan and the U.S. will open a string of investments across the Philippine island of Luzon to accelerate the impact, the creation of high-impact infrastructure projects there, the so-called Luzon Corridor, which will be part of the U.S. Partnership for Global Infrastructure and Investment, will connect Subic Bay, Clark, Manila, and Batangas. It will also include investments in transportation, clean energy, and semiconductors, among others. Philippine Ambassador to the U.S., Jose Manuel Romualdez, has earlier said the country is expected to receive at least $100 billion in investments from Washington and Tokyo over the next 5 to 10 years. Some workers of local governments in Metro Manila will need to extend their working hours as part of a skeletal workforce between 4 to 5 p.m. as agencies shift to the modified working hours schedule. The Metro Manila Council earlier issued a resolution mandating LGUs in the Metro to adjust working hours in government offices to 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. from the current 8 to 5 p.m. window starting Monday, April 15th. This is part of government's efforts to ease traffic congestion in the region during rush hours. Metro Manila Council President San Juan, Mayor Francis Zamora, says a skeletal workforce will be needed as the public will still need to adjust to the new schedule.
Hindi naman po makakadisrupt sa serbisyo ng lungsod ang isang oras. At mag-iiwan naman po tayo ng skeletal force from 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. for frontline services, dahil baka meron pa rin mga darating po between 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. Asahan po nila na meron pa rin skeletal workforce na may iwan po sa City Hall.
Some cities, however, expect minimal impact, like Marikina, which estimates only around 30% of LGU's workforce will be affected by the new schedule because the city has already been implementing flexible working hours. The National Food Authority Council has approved a higher buying price for unhusked rice, locally known as palay, to stay competitive. Under the new guidelines, dry palay can be bought from 23 to 30 pesos per kilo, while fresh palay will have a buying price of 17 to 23 pesos. This is higher than the previous 19 to 23 pesos per kilo buying price for both fresh and dry unhusked rice. The move comes after NFA reported it has been struggling to procure palay this harvest season due to lower prices compared to private counterparts. Aside from the approval of higher buying prices, the NFA Council also approved a program that will modernize their operations. Some bad news for motorists. Oil prices seen rising for a fourth straight week. Next week, the Philippine Energy Department expects gasoline to increase by at least 20 centavos, while diesel and kerosene may climb by as much as 1 peso next Tuesday. The DOE still attributes the higher pump prices to the ongoing conflict in the Middle East, particularly in Gaza. Various government agencies preparing for next week's transport strike by Piston and Manibela against the PUV modernization program. The Philippine National Police says it is coordinating with the groups to identify areas that will be affected by the rally. It will also deploy mobility assets to help stranded passengers.
Bibigay po natin sa kanila yung araw na yan, of course, but we will exercise as usual yung maximum tolerance para naman po hindi po magkakaon ng anumang gulo kung darating po yung araw na talagang magrarally po sila sa mga kalsada po natin.
Meanwhile, the Land Transportation Franchising and Regulatory Board, or LTFRB, assures the public there will be enough libreng sakay vehicles deployed, especially in areas that are expected to see a shortage of public transport like Sukat and Quezon City. It stressed the PUV consolidation must be completed by April 30, a final extension as mandated by President Bongbong Marcos, or operators will have their franchises revoked. The agency estimates 79% of operators have already consolidated. Our first guest this morning comes from the family that's been making the so-called King of the Road Jeepney since 1947 or post-World War II. An icon in Philippine transport, Francisco Motors has unveiled an ambitious plan to manufacture modern jeepneys, and under its Chuper Hero program, give some of them away. How? We're glad its chairman, Elmer Francisco, joins us live this morning. Elmer, hi. Good morning. Thank you so much for taking our call.
Hi, Mimi. Good morning. Thank you for having me in your show.
All right. Elmer, you know, much has been said about the PUV modernization, so I want to start from a different angle. You are a second-generation Francisco, I understand. It was your dad who set it up, and you're passing the baton soon to your son as well. I wonder, this PUV modernization program, do you see this as the next leg of growth for Francisco Motors?
Yes, actually, yun yung, ano, that's something that we are looking at. And it's really a chance, not only for Francisco Motors, but it's a chance for the Philippines to industrialize, finally. So this is our chance. So why are we giving it to foreign manufacturers when we local manufacturers can build better jeepneys than what they are doing? Mm-hmm. So that's actually our question.
Mm-hmm. Better jeepneys. Local manufacturers can build better jeepneys. That takes me to my next question. Does the local industry have the manufacturing capacity? Do we have the supply chain, the logistical chain, and the financial muscle to take on this daunting task and compete? If you think about it, with China-made cars that are very cheap, you can get them for as low as 500,000 pesos.
Yes, actually, Mimi, I've always believed that we have to think big to solve smaller problems. In fact, the jeepney manufacturing of Francisco Motors is just a tiny part of the bigger project that we are doing because we are developing a special economic zone, a 200-hectare special economic zone in Camarines Norte, of which the jeepney manufacturing is just one of those locators in that economic zone, wherein we are inviting all of the suppliers in the supply chain of the manufacturing of electric jeepneys to locate in that special economic zone. So this endeavor will generate a lot of jobs for Filipinos here at home, of which if we continue to import minibuses from other countries like China, India, or wherever, we are taking away jobs that are supposed to be for the Filipino workforce. Mm-hmm. So this is one of the reasons why Francisco Motors is doing this, to preserve or to save the jobs that are supposed to be for Filipinos and not export those jobs to other countries.
I wonder, Elmer, and this is I'm personally curious. I would like to know and visualize, how does your manufacturing facility look like today? We all know how the jeepney is iconic. It's very rich in history. But when you go to, for example, a Francisco Motors facility, what do we see? Do we see automated supply chains moving these jeepneys from one point to the next? Or is it mostly, do we see lateros? What's the plan here? Do you buy the engines abroad and then just, you know, isasalpak na lang yung katawan ng jeepney? How will this work?
Okay, absolutely.
How advanced?
Yes, Mimi, we have been building jeepneys for 77 years already. So ever since 1947 to 1959, lahat yan surplus. Galing yan sa military jeeps that were left by the U.S. Army after World War II. But since 1960, lahat ng jeepney na ginagawa ng Francisco Motors ay 100% brand new. So 1960, we brought in Isuzu to the Philippines. So we used Isuzu engines from Japan. Then we added Mazda in the 1970s. So dalawang engines ng Francisco Motors. So Isuzu and Mazda. But recently, since we already, dito sa PUV modernization program, we already have the yung EVIDA, yung Electric Vehicle Industry Development Act, which was passed last April 2022, which enables us to locally build or locally manufacture our own drivetrains, our electric drivetrains. Because of this, we will no longer be importing engines from foreign manufacturers. We will be mass producing them in our facility that we are building at Camarines Norte. So since you asked, dati, even in the 80s and 90s, without automation, without computers, ang mass production or assembly line ng Francisco Motors sa Las Piñas ay nakakagawa ng 12,000 units per year. So, ganun ang ano natin. Kasi mass production yan, hindi yan yung pok-pok-pok-pok sa backyard.
Oh, wow. All right.
Hindi ganun yan. Mass production talaga yan. Because Francisco Motors, hindi lang naman jeepney yung ginawa natin. We also built commercial vehicles, trucks, buses, vans, yung mga Mazda na pickups, mga vans, and also cars. We also brought in Hyundai from South Korea sa Pilipinas and Fiat from Italy. So marami tayong ibang experience sa ibang mga vehicles, not only the jeepneys. We also have the locally developed Anfra na utility vehicle and Pinoy na utility vehicles. So basically, what we're doing right now is yung sa Las Piñas namin na planta, we already closed it down because we're transferring to Camarines Norte sa Special Economic Zone so that we can avail of fiscal and non-fiscal incentives from the government so that we could further lower the costs of production. So, natutuwa ako dahil ang PESA, meron na silang domestic market enterprise of which we can cater to the domestic market aside from keeping our eyes on export because in the future, we will be exporting.
Oh, wow.
So, gagawa tayo dito ng ating mga electric vehicles. And Francisco Motors has gone full electric. So, we will not be building fossil fuel powered vehicles anymore. Oh, then, aside from the battery electric vehicles, we are also going to the direction of hydrogen. So hydrogen fuel cells for our land transportation and also for our eVTOLs. eVTOLs are electric vertical takeoff and landing vehicles. So soon enough, maybe next year, you'll be seeing flying jeepneys.
Exciting times. But before we get to the flying jeepneys, let's talk about the special economic zone in Camarines Norte. When will it be fully operational? When are you making the big move? And how many players are currently signed up for this special economic zone? It's a 200-hectare property, you say?
Yes. So it's a 200-hectare property. Yan yung pinag-uusapan namin ni Governor Dong Padilla of Camarines Norte and also Director General Teo Panga ng PESA. So we will start developing the 30 hectares out of the 200 hectares. Kasi yung 30 hectares, meron na yung presidential proclamation as a special economic zone. So we can already start developing that. So nandun tayo sa ano sa point na yun ngayon, we will be starting land development, then we will be putting our equipment, our plant and equipment for the manufacturing ng ano, mass production ng jeepneys, na electric jeepneys. So we will also be mass producing the drivetrains there, your electric drivetrains and the batteries. So we will have those locally produced yung mga drivetrains, of which hindi lang yung para sa Francisco Motors. Ang plano namin, nakikipag-usap din kami sa ibang mga local manufacturers, katulad sila sa Rao. We can also supply drivetrains to them and also local manufacturers. Kasi hindi naman madamot si Francisco. So we are sharing.
So you're confident, Elmer, that you can, you know, gather the key critical suppliers needed to set up an EV supply chain in that ecozone?
Yes, Mimi. So we are starting, but alam mo, ang Francisco Motors kasi hindi kami bago dun sa electric na, no, na space. Because since the 1980s, meron na tayong ano, electric jeepneys. Pati electric. 1980s pa. Pero of course, the battery technology back then was different. Lead acid deep cycle pa yung batteries noon. Ngayon lithium na. Then, like what I said, soon enough, maybe by next year, we will replace already the lithium batteries by with hydrogen fuel.
What is the difference, Elmer, for those who are not technical? What's the difference between EV that runs on lithium versus hydrogen fuel cell?
Number one difference is the range. So yung range niyan, ang battery kasi, ano, very limited ang range. Kasi as you add more batteries, bumibigat yung sasakyan. So yung range mo, parang hindi na nagiging efficient. So you can go as maybe 400 kilometers or 500 kilometers with hydrogen. You can have more range, like 500 to 900 kilometers.
Oh, wow.
Kasi ang battery electric, you charge it sa charging stations, of which Francisco Motors din ang maglalagay ng charging stations sa lahat ng lugar na magde-deploy tayo ng electric jeepneys. But with hydrogen, you will just refuel it with hydrogen, green hydrogen. So yun, part din yung ginagawa ng Francisco Motors in collaboration with different companies, both local and foreign, will be producing green hydrogen, yung produced by renewable sources.
Mm-hmm. All right. So let's, from this special economic zone, let's talk about your Chuper Hero program. You've actually been pitching this to government, but I heard it's taking a very long time to get approvals, considering that you plan to give away some of these EVs to drivers. How will this work? What's the business model here? You own the electric jeepneys and the operators are just partners. How about the drivers? Walk us through the process.
Okay, the Superhero program. First, sino mga pwedeng sumali sa Superhero program ng Francisco Motors? Ito yung proposal natin sa DOTR and sa LTFRB, of which yung pag-uusap namin ay ongoing. Nagpapasalamat nga ako sa inyo pati sa ibang mga kasamahan natin sa media. Dahil sa inyo, medyo bumilis-bilis ng konti yung pagsagot ng LTFRB. So before our interview, I was in another interview. The new USEC of Department of Transportation, si Andy Ortega, is now coordinating with me. Mm-hmm. And he's also talking to Chairman Guadis of LTFRB on the best way forward. So I'm very optimistic na nandyan si USEC Ortega. He's been 2 days as USEC, but he was the chairman of OTC before that. Mm-hmm. I'm very confident that na medyo bibilis yung proseso nito.
So what is the process? How will this work?
Yes, so the Superhero program is, ang pwedeng sumali dito ay yung mga jeepney operators with valid franchises. So it could be yung mga transport cooperatives, transport corporations. So ang nagbibigay naman ng valid franchises is LTFRB. So it's part of it. So lahat sila pwedeng sumali. And lahat ng sasali, meron sila mga lumang jeep. Diba? So yung mga lumang jeep nila, we can still use them to operate them and help them na lumaki yung kita nila. Because we will have the unlimited rides na tickets. Isa yan sa proposal natin sa LTFRB, of which pinag-aaralan nilang mabuti. Yung unlimited rides, it's just like sa ibang developed countries na kapag sumakay ka ng train, you can buy a ticket, you can hop on, hop off unlimited times in a day or in a week or in a month. So depende sa ticket na bibilin mo. Mm-hmm. So kung kayang gawin yun ng developed countries, why can't we do it here sa Philippines? So of course, I understand that LTFRB has to follow some existing rules and regulations, existing laws. But of course, we can never have progress if we will just follow the old rules, old laws na dekada-dekada na rin katanda yung mga rules na yan. So we have to change certain things for us to have real progress. Now, why are we doing this? Ang problema kasi ng mga operators natin is the cost ng mga sasakyan. So kung ang problema nila ay cost, bakit ang solusyon is hindi pa utangin? Diba? We create a business model na hindi yung lulubog sila sa utang. We create a business model that is sustainable enough that we can actually give the jeepneys for free. Kasi dito sa model na to, we will have yung unlimited rides nga. So dito sa unlimited rides tickets na to, dyan kukunin yung sweldo ng mga drivers, dyan kukunin yung kita ng mga transport cooperatives. Of course, Francisco Motors will have a profit also because we are a social enterprise. It's a business. Hindi naman kami DSWD.
Elmer, you mentioned earlier, pwedeng gamitin ng mga operators yung mga lumang jeepney nila. So you will convert these jeepneys?
No. Pwede pa nilang gamitin yung jeepneys nila. Kasi ang rule ng LTFRB is from the approval ng LPTRP or Land Public Transport Route Plan, from that approval, binibigan sila ng 27 months or a little more than 2 years to replace the old jeepneys with modernized units. So within that
period.
Yes. So within that period, ang gagawin natin, continue pa rin. So magkoconsolidate sila, di ba? Then tuloy-tuloy pa rin, gagamitin pa rin yung mga old jeepneys nila hanggang sa unti-unti natin mapalitan ng modernized units. But the difference is wala silang kailangan bayaran. We'll give these jeepneys to them for free. Then, aside from that, ang maintenance ito, kasi under warranty, lifetime yung warranty niya. So, yun yung maganda.
Okay.
So, yes. So, ang maganda dyan, yung mga pasahero, makakatipid din sila dahil doon sa unlimited rides. So, instead of paying every time sasakay sila, they'll just be paying once in a month.
All right. Elmer, just very quickly, we're showing live footage from the Philippine Stock Exchange. This is coming to us live from Taguig. The countdown to the special bell ringing. This is for the listing of Cebu Land Master's 5 billion peso follow-on offer. 3, 2, and 1. I hope we have a sound here. All right, just imagine the sound, but it's a special. We are seeing Mr. Sobedano, the father, his son Joe, shaking hands now with PSC President Ramon Monson. Of course, the third guy from the bell wearing a gray suit. We just had him about a few weeks ago. That's Grant Cheng, the CFO. So again, this is for the 5 billion peso follow-on offer of Cebu Land Masters. This comprised of 5 million Series A preferred shares, 1,000 apiece issued in two sub-series, that's Series A1 and A2. The funds raised will be used to partially finance project development and capex. The Visman developer, as we reported a few weeks ago, posted a 29% growth in full year 2023, consolidated net income at 4.6 billion, as revenue grew 20% to nearly 19 billion pesos. More on that later. I think we can go back to Elmer just very quickly. Hi, Elmer. Sorry about that. We just had to bring in the live shots from the stock exchange.
Yeah, actually, it's like I heard the actual ringing of the bell. Tatabi ko lang yung Philippine Stock Exchange.
Oh, all right. Elmer, just speaking of investors, Maharlika Investment Fund is keen on putting money into your project, into your ambitious plan. Where are you on that?
Yeah, we're talking. We haven't agreed on anything yet, anything concrete. We're talking si Joel Consing, pati yung board ng Maharlika. But what we are talking about are about the terminals. Because Francisco Motors, hindi lang jeepney ginagawa natin. Like what I mentioned, the manufacturing is just a tiny part of the bigger plan. Part of it is we will put up terminals, jeepney terminals. We have an ambitious plan of putting up 100 terminals. That's one for each province, 82 provinces, then 17 sa Metro Manila and one central. So ang pinag-uusapan namin ng Maharlika Investment Corporation is for them to fund the first terminal. So yun pala yung pinag-uusapan namin ngayon. Of which, ang pinag-uusapan namin is I'm coordinating with the office of House Speaker Romualdez. Because we are looking into idle government properties owned by the national government. Because with that, magiging yung non-performing asset ng government, magiging revenue generating. Aside from that, we don't have to buy the property. So makakatipid tayo doon. That's one. It could be a tripartite agreement. So owned by the national government, then Maharlika Investment Corporation may fund the development, then we can operate the terminal. Sa terminal, magkakaroon yan ng ano. Of course, yung mga modernized jeepneys natin, dyan yung terminal. We'll have service base, after sales parts, and we'll have depots for our ano, charging stations and hydrogen. So yan yung ano, isang pinag-uusapan namin ng ano, MIC.
All right, how much investments will the MIC need to make? To make this work? Because you're looking at them funding just one, the first one, right?
Yes, actually for the whole for the whole project, yung 100 terminals, that would cost us around $200 million. I'm sorry, $500 million. But since it's one terminal, let's just do the math. It's around $5 million.
For a start.
Yes, for the for the first terminal.
Oh wow. And how do you plan to bankroll the rest of the 99 terminals that you plan to set up?
Yeah, actually, aside from internal funding, we also have ongoing negotiations with many different financing companies, financing institutions, both foreign and domestic. So yung sa foreign, medyo malaki-laki din. They're very interested. Alam mo, ang pinaka-interesado sila is the green portion of it. Kasi ano nga eh, renewable energy, renewable sources, electric vehicles, then we're going for hydrogen. Then aside from that, I also got a pledge 2 days ago, of which ina-announce yan ngayon as we speak. Ina-announce yan ngayon ni Climate Change Commission Commissioner Albert de la Cruz sa Kapihan sa Manila Hotel. Our COO, Mr. Christian San Jose, is there with him right now. I-announce niya yan dahil nag-pledge siya na 200 million pesos para dito sa project na to. For igagawa natin ang mga electric jeepneys for us to give away for free.
And Elmer, how many electric jeepneys are you looking to give away for free again?
As many as we can, actually. Because with this business model, Mimi, we can give all jeepneys for free. With this business model that we did, yung sa superhero program, of which nilagay kuya ng klarong-klaro sa LTFRB, I understand that their hands are tied, they have to follow certain rules, but the way to move forward is to keep the communications open so we can work on on possible solutions. Because we're not hindi madali naman kaming kausap.
All right.
We can make adjustments, diba, dun sa dun sa mga policies. Pati mga kung kahit meron tayong kailangan sundin, existing policies, we can do that.
Final question, Elmer. Are you looking at welcoming new investors into Francisco Motors, maybe tapping the capital markets, going public, raising funds?
Yes, we are talking. Actually, nag-uusap kami kahit SEC, nag-uusap kami regarding that. But for now, alam mo, sabi mo nga, Mimi, it's an ambitious plan. My plan is to go for the unicorn status. So we're not going public anytime soon because we have a unique situation here. And it's achievable, di ba? Maganda na meron tayong Filipino-owned and Filipino-grown company to become a unicorn. So a unicorn is a business that is valued at least $1 billion.
How soon?
Then we'll go public.
Okay, and when will this unicorn be born?
Ginagawa pa namin eh. So,
5 years?
We will let you know.
All right.
Hopefully before that.
All right. On that note, Elmer, thank you so much for joining us, for walking us through the manufacturing requirements of a modernized jeepney. We are very excited to see what you will do with the Chipper Hero program and for this unicorn to be born. Thank you again and have a great weekend.
Thank you, Mimi.
All right. Now, here's a look at the other stories we're tracking in the newsroom today. Happening within the hour, the Franchise Asia Philippines Expo 2024 will kick off with over 700 franchise brands expected to attend. In the next hour at around 10, the Metro Manila Council will discuss adjustments in the working hours of government offices in the metro to ease traffic congestion. And we'll also monitor today the continued trilateral summit between the Philippines, Japan, and the U.S. Time for a short break coming up. Now on a 6-day losing streak, could the PSEI be primed for a rebound? Market chat with Ferdinand Subido of AP Securities is next. When we return, stay with AMC. You're still watching Market Edge. The headlines: U.S. President Joe Biden vowing an ironclad commitment to defend the Philippines in the face of China's growing maritime aggression. Former President Rodrigo Duterte denies conceding anything to China during his administration. And disgraced football hero O.J. Simpson dies of cancer. The PSE index tumbled back to the 6,600 level on Thursday, down 1%, as net foreign selling hit a quarter of a billion. Joining us now for more in the markets is Ferdinand Subido. He is Senior Research Analyst at AP Securities. Ferdinand, hi. Good morning.
Hi, good morning. Thanks for having me today.
All right, so it seems like it's pretty listless. This market is pretty confused where to go. The market is trading flat. We're up by just 2 points, 66.79. You know, in the next few weeks, earnings become the next big driver of markets. Do you think the Q4 season raised the bar so high and estimates have raised substantially that it becomes extra tougher for local companies to top even meet the expectations? I mean, what are you expecting to see for Q1 earnings?
All right. Actually, on that, I don't really think that the Q4 earnings really raised the bar that high. Actually, we were monitoring our roster of covered companies, and we actually saw that while there was still a significant number of outperformers, there was actually also quite a solid number of performances that were just in line with analyst estimates, along with a handful of results that were below what consensus was expecting. So looking ahead to Q1 earnings, I think generally we would most likely still see earnings that are more or less in line with analysts' expectations. So on the banking side, I think that interest income, lending revenues would still be quite hefty given that we are still in a high rate environment, and coupled alongside with this, we are seeing some strengthening in loan growth as well. And then on property, malls have been actually quite a strong driver for property revenues. So that's one factor we're looking out for in that end. And then for consumer, though, I think that's one probably sector wherein we might still see some weakness, given that high costs of living have really weighed on the spending habits of consumers. And given that, we could still see some possible scrimping by consumers when it comes to their expenditures.
Mm-hmm. All right. So we are expecting, you did talk about banks, they tend to kick off the earnings season. The sector has been one of the better ones in the last quarters because of rates. So we are watching out for banks. So is there a number that you're looking at, an average corporate earnings growth for Q1?
Okay, for banks, I think I'm expecting average corporate earnings growth of still in the low to mid-teens, actually.
In general, across the board, across sectors?
Across the board, probably around high single digits, to mid to high single digits. I think that's reasonable to expect.
Mid to high single digits. All right. And when you zoom out a little bit outside of the earnings season, did anything change for you this week? I mean, we got inflation print from the U.S. We got the BSP's hawkish commentary on Monday, hawkish pause there. Is there anything that you're seeing that seems to validate what many have already started to talk about a couple of weeks ago, that there will be no rush to cut rates? Does this market feel like it's rushing, or does the market feel like it's accepting and starting to, you know, just accept the fact that these rate cuts will not happen as soon as we all hoped?
Well, definitely, yeah, yesterday, following the release of CPI figures in the U.S., that was a big talking point amongst investors in the market. So on our end, yes, we're actually subscribing to the notion that rate cuts here at home might potentially be delayed. So initially, we were looking at the month of June for our first rate cut, but now we're pushing this back to back a little bit to August. So our reasoning here is that while yes, the BSP has communicated in the past that they would want monetary policy to now be more disconnected from the Fed's movements, it still can't be ignored that the movements of the Federal Reserve with regards to rates will still have an impact on the currency. So while there may be an impact on the USD peso side, Simultaneously, the BSP cannot afford to delay for too long, given that that might result in headwinds already for our already struggling GDP growth. So, which is why we landed at the middle ground around August.
So you're expecting rate cuts to begin in August, a middle ground, as you say. How many cuts and how deep?
We're factoring in around three rate cuts, so that's a total of 75 basis points. Probably the highest it can go would be around 100 if ever growth really starts to struggle.
And you know, we were talking about this since last year. When rates start going down, it's going to be party time for equity investors. So what is your year-end forecast for the PSEI? I mean, if we're going to be chatting December this year, at the end of this year, where do you think the index will be by then?
All right. We're actually, we're still sticking true to our conviction of around 7,600 by year-end. So in our view, this is actually quite reasonable given that our forecast factored in around only three rate cuts along with modest earnings growth for the PSEI. So we're still sticking true to that, yeah.
That's actually one of the more aggressive that we've had. Many are saying it's 7.1, 7.2, and we're almost there already. But you guys are at 7.6. We're coming from, let me just check where we're coming from. We actually ended last year at 6.4, so that's over 10% gain yield from the index year on year if we do end at 7.6. A welcome development considering we've had, what, 3-4 years of negative returns. In the meantime, I think we are now ready for your blind item. Oh, but before that, we have this. Today we had the listing for the follow-on offer of Cebu Land Masters, and now we're getting this. Arthurland Corporation is set to offer up to 4 million peso-denominated preferred shares with an oversubscription of 2 million and an offer price of 500 pesos per share. Are you seeing encouraging signs from fundraising activities at the stock exchange at this point?
At this point, mostly the capital raising we've just been seeing is in preferred shares. So I think the preferred shares offering is meant to leverage the appetite of investors for fixed rates, given that, you know, the expectation eventually down the line is for rate cuts. So companies are likely saying, all right, let's capture the whatever segment of investor is there that would be satisfied with relatively high rates, given that next year rates will likely be lower. So the high preferred dividend rates give investors the opportunity to lock in those higher yields compared to what they would likely get by next year. However, for the coming months, I think in order to truly gauge the success of capital raise, the state of capital raising in the market this year, we would have to look at the upcoming C-REC IPO as our benchmark. So if that goes well, then most likely that could raise some further optimism amongst corporates here in the capital market. So that would further entice as well investors to place their money in new fundraising, given that the benchmark would provide positive performance if ever the T-REC IPO goes well.
All right. Lots of things to watch out for. In the meantime, I think we're ready for your blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely and that you like. Don't tell us, just describe. We're going to leave our viewers to guess what this is. What do you have for us today?
All right. So actually, this is kind of tricky to describe without giving it away. Yeah.
Let's try.
I'll just try to be very general about it. It's a property company. It's been expanding globally.
You're giving it away. But go ahead.
Yeah. Well, it has a number of significant properties, I think, in Pasay, the Pasay area. Yeah. And we're seeing around at least 27% upside, given that recent overseas capital raising initiatives have really jacked up the value of one of its subsidiaries. Yeah.
And it just celebrated its 10th year listing anniversary yesterday, right?
Yeah.
Okay. 27% upside in the next 6 to 12 months, correct?
Yes, 1 year target.
All right. think it was a giveaway, but let's see. Thank you so much, Ferdinand, for joining us. It was a pleasure speaking with you and picking your brain this morning. We'll see you soon. Have a great weekend.
Thank you. Have a good day, too.
All right. The venture capitalist Blitz Scaling Ventures urging government to proceed cautiously with AI regulations to foster greater opportunities without stifling innovation. Nations have been actively pursuing the regulation of the new technology due to its potential to surpass human intelligence, which could result in unintended consequences. Now, in November last year, 25 countries, including the US, China, and those from the EU, actually agreed to collaborate on developing a unified approach to AI oversight.
There has been a lawsuit, or regulatory lawsuit from Europe. One of the countries has fined Google for indexing their content and turning it into AI. And it's hundreds of billion dollars worth of fines. Europe has put forth very stringent regulations around AI from US-based countries. Now, the upside of this is it protects their culture. The downside is it reduces the opportunity for innovation in their own cultures. So countries' instincts are to regulate technically Silicon Valley and the Seattle area where a lot of these technologies are coming from.
Yeah.
But they need to be careful. If they do this in the wrong way, their entrepreneurs are not going to want to build the AI models of their own country.
Right.
They're just going to flee and come to the West Coast United States, which is happening in abundance.
Time now to zip through the top headlines from major business papers from Business World. Philippine rice imports totaled 1.15 million metric tons in the first quarter. That's up 44% year on year, the country's Plant Industry Bureau says. Vietnam remains the country's top supplier of rice, accounting for 62% of all imports. From Business Mirror, Manila ranks 121st out of 142 cities worldwide in an index that measures cities' readiness and utilization of advanced technologies to foster sustainable communities. The Philippine capital's ranking in this year's Smart City Index was six notches lower than its 115th finish last year. And from the Philippine Star, the Philippine Education Department reports so far some 5,800 of the 48,000 public schools nationwide, that's about 10%, a little more than 10%, have suspended in-person classes due to the hot weather worsened by the El Nino phenomenon. Now, here's a quick look at the flash business headlines from overseas. A Vietnam court sentences real estate tycoon Truong Mai Lan to death for her role in a $12 billion fraud case. The chairwoman of Van Tran Phat Group was arrested in 2022 for charges including bribery of government officials and violation of bank lending rules. She was also accused of embezzling funds from Saigon Commercial Bank between 2018 to 2022. Lan's trial put the spotlight on Vietnam's years-long anti-corruption campaign spearheaded by the Communist Party. In other news, shares of Morgan Stanley fell 5.3% to nearly $87 on Thursday, the most in 5 months, after a report that U.S. regulators are scrutinizing the firm's efforts to prevent potential money laundering by wealthy clients. The increase focused on the firm's wealth management arm, generating almost half the company's revenue last year. The U.S. government has been ramping up pressure on the industry to tighten money laundering controls. Moving on, an analyst says UBS might need to retain $10 to $15 billion in excess capital after the Swiss government laid out plans for tougher capital requirements for the enlarged lender. Autonomous research analyst Stefan Stallman says UBS would need 200 to 300 basis points more in Common Equity Tier 1 ratio, which is a measure of a bank's resilience. The government's recommendations is part of New Switzerland's efforts to shield the country from a repeat of the collapse of Credit Suisse. In other news, Ford set to ship 144,000 of its redesigned F-150, its best-selling model and Ranger pickup truck, to North American dealers. Ford stopped the shipment of these vehicles earlier due to quality problems. Its latest move will be critical for Ford to hit its 2024 pre-tax profit target of $10 to $12 billion. Meanwhile, Apple preparing to overhaul its entire Mac line with a new family of in-house processors designed to highlight artificial intelligence. The company, which released its first Macs with M3 chips 5 months ago, is reportedly nearing production of the next generation M4 processor. The new chip will come in at least three main varieties, and Apple is looking to update every Mac model with it. The new chips are part of Apple's broader push to weave AI capabilities into all of its products. And finally, Taylor Swift's music now back on TikTok despite an ongoing dispute between her record label and the social video platform. Universal Music Group pulled the songs of its recording artists and songwriters from TikTok in February after failing to come to terms on a new licensing agreement. Universal said TikTok failed to adequately compensate it for the songs, while TikTok accused the record label of putting its own interests above that of the artists. The timing also coincides with the impending release of Swift's newest album, The Tortured Poets Department, on April 19th. It's next Friday. We're all excited. Now, before we go, for those who try to guess the blind item, not so blind. It's pretty much a giveaway. It's a Double Dragon, 27% upside in the next 6 to 12 months. Do let us if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. In the meantime, that's it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC. Have a great weekend, everybody.